What should educators avoid doing when collecting progress monitoring data?
I'm going to talk about some important things to avoid doing when you collect progress monitoring data. First thing I want to talk about is about using the same measure every time you do progress monitoring. It's really important to administer the same progress monitoring measure every time that you collect progress monitoring data. What I sometimes see happen that you do not want to do is to collect progress monitoring data using different progress monitoring systems and make the assumption that the data you get from them are all the same. So, for example, schools often use oral reading fluency as a way to measure students' progress, and for many grade levels, it's a great measure to use. And schools will select something like DIBLS or AIMSWeb or any system. It doesn't matter which one you use, provided it has reliability data. Perhaps from the NCII tools chart, you can select a measure from there. So I'll see schools use something like DIBLS or AIMSWeb, and then in addition, they will have data from a running record, maybe a teacher's college formal running record, or even an informal one done on a grade level text. And they'll mix that in with the progress monitoring data from something like DIBLS. And I might see them include data from different grade level passages. So they have a student who's reading below grade level, and so they will, let's say a student is a fourth grader, they'll collect fourth grade progress monitoring data, and then they'll have second grade progress monitoring data. And they'll put the data from the fourth grade progress monitoring, from the running records, and from the below grade level progress monitoring, all in the same graph. And when you do that, you get data that often sort of zigzag. They sort of have spikes and valleys, and the reason is that those data are not equivalent because they are different systems. Even if you use DIBLS 1 week and AIMSWeb a different week, you're not going to get consistent data because those are different systems that have different norms. So you have to use just one system. One related point is that schools will sometimes ask, well, we have a student who is ready for a new grade level. We've made a lot of progress with our intensive intervention plan. We'd like to move the student, let's say, from second grade to third grade progress monitoring. If schools want to do that, it's a great thing. Congratulations for the student in making that great improvement. It's a good idea then to use a couple weeks of overlap where you're administering the second grade and third grade progress monitoring measures at the same time, so that when you switch to the third grade one only, you'll have some data to sort of show where the third grade data started. And you often find when you do that, the student scores in the next grade level are somewhat lower because the words are more difficult. Again, that's not a problem. It's just important to make sure that you are using those data at the same time. And once you switch to third grade, you can't go back. You're stuck with the measure you've chosen because you have to use the same measure every time. Second important point about progress monitoring is to administer the progress monitoring the same way every time. I know it's tempting to change the way you administer progress monitoring, especially if students aren't doing well, and you want to change the context or change something else so that they will do better on the progress monitoring. For example, you might find that a student seems to do poorly because you collect the data in a room full of kids in the middle of intervention time, and you feel like the kid is distracted, you feel like the student is distracted. The distracted does make sense to change the location. But you have to do that the same way every time. In other words, you can't collect the data in the classroom with a bunch of kids 1 week, and then in a different room another week, and then back to the main classroom another week. If you change it, again, you're gonna get sort of spikes and valleys in the data, and that's not going to allow you to see how the student's doing. Sometimes people won't use the same instructions every time, they'll change them. For example, sometimes with the math progress monitoring, students forget to skip around. It's important for some of the progress monitoring measures for students to skip ones that they don't understand. And schools will teach the students explicitly how to do that really carefully so the students complete more problems. It's fine to do that the first time you administer it. And if you're going to do that, you need to do it consistently. Because once you change it, it's hard to know if the data are the same. So if you notice there's an improvement in their data from the week before you gave the extra instruction to the week after you gave the extra instruction, you don't know if the reason the student is improving is because of your intensive intervention or because you just gave them more instruction about how to do progress monitoring. So it's critical that you use the same instructions every time. Another issue in terms of administering the assessments is in terms of providing the same amount of encouragement for the student. So sometimes if students are struggling, people will add extra incentives and sort of pump them up a lot more before they do the progress monitoring. It's great to give them some incentives every time. It's great to encourage them every time, but you have to do it every time, not just when you feel like the data are sort of flattening out. Because if you do that, you don't know that if you get an increase again, whether the increase is due to the student improving from intervention, or again, whether the student is just improving because you gave them more encouragement. One really problematic thing that I don't see often, but I have seen in some schools, is that people actually change the amount of time that they give the students to complete the assessment based on the perception of whether the student can sort of handle additional time. So for example, the maze, or in Dibble's, the days, is designed to be administered for 2.5 or 3 minutes. And sometimes teachers will give the students additional time so have an opportunity to get more correct. If you change the amount of time students get, your data are not at all useful, because if you give them more time, they'll be able to get more right. And we are trying to see whether or not instruction is improving the number they get right, not the amount of time when you collected the assessment data. So it's critical that you collect data in the exact same way, with the exact same amount of time, every time you do it, because if you don't do it that way, students' improvement could be due to the fact that you changed the amount of time students are allowed to take the assessment. Beyond administration, it's also critical to use the same scoring procedures. So sometimes you'll have a student with a speech concern who tends to say a sound in a non-standard way. So a student might say the sound more like a W, or the R sound more like a W. So sometimes students will say twee for tree or something similar to that. And one of the things that happens is that schools will decide that it's important to allow the twee to count as tree, knowing the student has a speech problem. That is completely appropriate to do. But if you do it, you need to make clear that you've done it, because you're going to be changing the scoring. Previously, maybe you counted twee as incorrect, and now you're counting it as correct. And as soon as you do that, you're changing the data. So they're getting more correct because you've given this new scoring procedure. So I want to say that it's important to make that change, because you want to give the student the credit for what they've completed. But you also need to note that you've done it, because every time you change it, you might get an increase in the data, and it might look to you like it's due to intervention, but it right might be really due to the change in the way you did progress monitoring. Another question about scoring related to that is about sort of regional differences or dialectical differences in students' pronunciation. And similar to kids with speech difficulty, I think it's completely appropriate to adjust the scoring for a student's dialect. So if you know that they say a particular word the same way every time, and it's not a question of not knowing how to say it, it's just a question of dialect, it's fine to use the scoring procedure that gives them credit for saying that word. But again, you need to note that you've done it and you need to score it consistently. If you don't, again, you don't know if the student's improvement is due to your change in the scoring rules or due to intervention. And so you need to make that clear every time.